Hi, and welcome to the first ever episode of Let's Talk Children's Lit. My name is Aarti, and today we are going to be discussing a debut novel by Becky Albertali named Simon vs. the Homosapiens Agenda. First of all, I want to start by saying how much I enjoyed reading this book. As a high school teacher, the language is familiar and comforting. The story evolves at a reasonably good pace. And because the story is centered on the protagonist's internal struggle, you learn to empathize with the main character, Simon Spear. The story is also interspersed with a lot of hard truths. While I was reading it, I would often go, wow, I didn't think of this that way. We're going to be looking at some of these hard truths today while we do an in-depth study of some of the prominent themes of the book. I am, however, going to start with a quick summary of the book. Don't worry, if you haven't read this already, I'm not going to spoil the ending for you. Okay, let's get started. Simon Spear is the main character of this book. He is a normal high school boy. He loves theater and music. He has some really wonderful friends, including Leah, Nick, and Abby. At home, his family is like a dream come true. Everyone cares for each other and loves each other. His family, including his younger sister Nora and older sister Alice, often get together to watch reality TV shows like The Bachelorette. However, Simon is holding on to one big secret: the fact that he is gay. He's holding on to one other big secret. He is romantically involved with a boy that he found on the school's Tumblr page. This boy is anonymously named Blue, and Simon and Blue have been exchanging emails and flirting for a while now. However, they have decided to keep their identity a secret. The book begins with Simon being gently blackmailed by a classmate named Martin. Martin recently discovered these emails between Simon and Blue in the computer at the library. Martin now threatens to expose the fact that Simon is gay if Simon does not help him with Abby. Yes, Martin likes Abby, and as Simon says, just like every other straight geeky boy in advanced placement. So now Simon is worried. Worried that the world will find out about him and Blue. Worried that Blue might stop talking to him. Worried that he has to come out to the world. Okay. That is enough context for the book. There are a lot of twists and turns and a love triangle, but I'm going to let you figure that out on your own. Okay, let's dig deep now, starting with the cover. One of the things that I adore about this book, similar to other contemporary YA novels now, is how the character's physical features are not talked about at all. This is why the cover looks like this. A teenager with a hoodie, but without a face. Here's another one. I love this aspect of YA novels because it is fighting against the stereotype of bucketing heroes and heroines as perfect-looking, popular girls or boys. It is a step away from Princess Tales and Mean Girls. And if you ask me, a step in the right direction. There's also one other version with Nick Robinson as Simon Spear. This one has a face, but if you want my advice, don't watch the movie. Totally not worth it. A little bit about the author. This is Becky Albertali. She holds a doctorate in clinical psychology from George Washington University. As a clinical psychologist, she often worked with teens battling with sexual identity, and that inspired her to write Simon vs. the Homosapiens Agenda. However, she swears that Simon is not based on any real one person. Now let's dive into prominent themes of the book. The first and the most obvious one is LGBTQ and gender conformity. The story is focused on the internal struggle of the main character, Simon Spear, who's secretly gay and is hoping to come out to the world. Despite the fact that he's confident that his parents will be okay with this, it is still a massive struggle for him. As a reader, you really understand the depth of the trauma that teens go through when dealing with this on their own. This quote specifically, I think, showcases his struggle well. It is definitely annoying that straight, and white for that matter, is the default, and that the only people who have to think about their identity are the ones who don't fit that mold. Straight people really should have to come out, and the more awkward it is, the better. Awkwardness should be a requirement. I guess this is sort of our version of the homosexual agenda. There are many important phrases here. Straight and white for that matter is the default, is one of them. Awkwardness is the other. The use of the word awkwardness is so carefully chosen by Albertali here, signifying the almost dull, chronic discomfort someone might feel in a situation like this. It is good to take a moment to think about what word would you associate or assume your community to associate with the act of hiding one's sexual identity. Is awkwardness the first word that pops into your mind? The most important part, however, is this one. I guess this is sort of our version of the homosexual agenda. It helps us understand the title of the book, Simon versus the Homosapiens Agenda, because Simon is advocating for the homosexual agenda, the fact that everybody needs to feel this awkward and everybody needs to figure out how they want to come out to the world. Straight, gay, bisexual, really, it shouldn't matter. There's a scene about this in the movie that I still insist you don't watch, except for this scene. Here it is.
Thinking about why I haven't come out. Maybe it's because it doesn't seem fair that only gay people have to come out. Why is straight the default?
I have something I need to tell you. Mom, there's something I have to tell you.
Can we talk?
Yeah. I'm straight. I'm sorry, Mom. It's true.
I like girls.
I like men.
You can definitely your dad, is that?
I'm in love with Nick. I feel like I've been raising a stranger.
Well, that was fun. Here's another quote that exemplifies the awkwardness associated with coming out. All I ever do is to come out. I try to change, but I keep changing in all these tiny ways. I get a girlfriend, I have a beer, and every freaking time I have to reintroduce myself to the universe all over again. This is an interesting quote because it emphasizes the struggle of coming out when you're hiding a big secret. Albertali, through this quote, is signifying how simple things like getting a beer or getting a girlfriend, which most adolescent children go through, suddenly becomes this uphill, exhausting task when coupled with revealing a non-confirming sexual identity. The tone of the quote is exhaustion. Both quotes actually helps the reader understand the frustration associated with the act of coming out. Let's move on to the second theme, adolescent love. I just want to take a moment here to adore this image that I found on Becky Albertali's official website. This is designed by Artist Rays. This is a cute and adorable picture of Blue and Simon, just like any other picture of people in love. This picture is, and I want to emphasize this, normal. Thank you, Artist Rays, for this image. I believe that is what Becky Albertali was going for here, that love is love no matter your sexual identity. And she has done a remarkable job at that. Let's look at this quote. He talked about the ocean between people and how the whole point of everything is to find a shore worth swimming to. This quote is something that can be applied to any situation, any love story, any relationship story for that matter. And if we were to compare Simon versus the Homo sapiens agenda to other contemporary stories of YA literature, such as The Fault in Our Stars and Eleanor and Park, then you will find that the tone and language is similar, portraying the universality of the language of love. Let's compare here. Look at these two quotes. One is from Simon versus the Homosapiens Agenda, and the other is from Eleanor and Park. He likes to imagine me fantasizing about sex. That's something I probably shouldn't have read right before bed. I lie here in the pitch darkness, reading that particular line on my phone again and again. I'm jittery and awake and completely in knots, all from an email. Holding Eleanor's hand was like holding a butterfly or a heartbeat, like holding something complete and completely alive. Look at this line. I'm jittery and awake and completely in knots. And then compare this to this line. Holding a butterfly or a heartbeat. On the one hand, you have jittery and knots. And on the other hand, you have butterfly and heartbeat. On the one hand, you have awake. And on the other hand, you have completely alive. If you didn't know that the text on the left is taken from a gay adolescent story, you really can't tell the difference. By using the universality of love, the author is able to normalize homosexuality. That, to me, is a huge achievement. The next important theme of the book is agency and control and coming of age. One could argue that all children's books are about agency and control. Simon Spear, in this novel, is struggling to reintroduce himself to the world. He's trying to figure out how his story should get out. He's trying to figure out how he should tell the world that he is gay. And while he knows that he's in charge of this, he's constantly finding that coming out, even in small ways, is an uphill battle. Let's look at this quote. My parents have a way of ruining things like this. They get so curious. It's like they have this idea of me, and whenever I step outside of that, it blows their mind. There's something so embarrassing about that in a way I can't even describe. One might assume that parents getting curious about their children's behavior is hardly a struggle. Becky Albertali, quite cleverly by using first-person narrative, is able to show us how it is a struggle for Simon. Because every time he's doing something new, he's testing the crowd to see how people react. The use of the word embarrassing here indicates fear, sorrow, or worry. Kind of like he's thinking, if you're reacting like this to me having coffee, what are you going to do when you realize I'm gay? Therefore, though it seems like Simon has all the agency to tell his story, he really does not. One of the more classic dilemmas of children's literature. Let's look at this quote. This is mine. I'm supposed to decide when and where and who knows and how I want to say it. This quote is also the climax of the book. I'm not going to exactly tell you why, but this part, the when and where and who, is the part that Simon is trying to figure out throughout the book. Okay. We now come to the end of this episode. If you'd like to add comments, please do so in the comment box below. A discussion about the book would be wonderful. If you'd like to watch more episodes about other books, please subscribe to Let's Talk Children's Lit. Bye!